Ladies and gentlemen, it's rather chilly morning, but I'm so glad to see you all in good health. We have many special guests, two ambassadors, ambassador from Germany and India, joined us this morning. The key word for the global economy today, I suppose, is uncertainty. And at the center of the uncertainty lies Eurozone economies, and therefore we all are very much interested in what's happening and what is going to happen in Eurozone economies. This morning we have the best scholar and policy advisor in Europe will share his views on these very critical issues. Guntram Wolf has been with us before, so I don't think he needs a long introduction. But I just want to say that he is with Bruegel Institute in Brussels, which is the leading economic think tank in Europe. Dr. Wolf's research has been focusing on the euro area economy and governance, on fiscal policy and global finance, and of course German economy. Actually, he is a German. origin, and he has joined the Bruegel from the European Commission again, where he worked on the macroeconomics of the euro area and the euro area governance reform. Prior to joining the Commission, he was an economist at the Deutsche Bundesbank, where he coordinated his research team on fiscal policy. He also worked for IMF as an advisor. So with this, you can easily see that he is the best person to enlighten us on the very questions and issues we are interested in. Finding out. With no further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Wolf to give his presentation. Please join me in thanking.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you very much to the IGE for having me today. It's a real honor to be here and to share with you my thoughts on the Eurozone, but also, of course, on the Eurozone's solution or non-solution of the crisis and the impact on the global economy. Now, I was asked, of course, many times, not just in Korea, but also in Europe, actually, whether the crisis is over or not, and what are the big challenges for 2013. And, of course, it's very difficult to give a precise answer to that question. But certainly, I see, I would say, three dimensions that are really important in 2013. One is certainly the political landscape in Europe. We've seen in Asia major changes in leadership in Japan, in China, and in Korea. Now in Europe we have two major elections this year, the Italian election and the German election. Now people have asked me which one is the more important one for Europe and for the Eurozone, and I tend to answer it is actually the Italian one. Because certainly one of the key factors for the stability of the Eurozone is the stability of Italy and the kind of reforms that the new government in Italy would put in place. The second really big issue I think that is on the table is the structural adjustment that is starting and has started quite significantly. As you remember, the Eurozone has had a very deep divergence of its economies in the first 10 years in terms of unit labor costs, in terms of current accounts, in terms of financial flows across countries, and of course with major housing bubbles in the south of Europe. Now this has adjusted, and it has started to adjust quite significantly. I think we can also be quite confident that some countries really have done a lot of effort. We see that in Spain, the external imbalances have been reduced very significantly, with the current account deficit having come down very significantly, and not just because of a compression in demand, but also because of very good export performance. But certainly, we have not finished this adjustment, the structural adjustment. So the structural adjustment needs to continue, and the big question is whether and how strongly it will continue this year. And I think that's absolutely crucial for the euro. Now, the third very important point is, I would say, a more institutional question, which is the big question of how will the governance, the institutions of the euro area, evolve in this year. Now, I have the view that this crisis, this Eurozone crisis, is not just a crisis of some countries in the south of Europe having behaved wrongly. That is a view that is advocated in my home country by many people, but also in other countries. But I really think it is a combination, of course, of bad behavior. I mean, that is for sure there. But it's also a failure of the institutional setup. And what Europe is doing currently, it is trying to improve this institutional setup. And I thought I would share with you and put the focus of my presentation on this institutional changes that Europe is currently undergoing, which are well known nowadays under the words banking union and fiscal union. And I thought I would really want to focus quite a lot on this in my presentation. It's quite specific, but I think it's really at the core of the institutional reform process that we see currently in Europe, and it's a very major effort that is undertaken. Now, the first big step is, of course, that has been taken. It is the common supervision to be situated in the European Central Bank. That is a very major endeavor. I would say it's probably the most ambitious institutional reform project since the creation of the euro. It is a major shift in the balance of power between the nation states, where currently banking supervision is still done, towards a centralized supervisory authorities in the European Central Bank, and I will discuss this in more detail. So I think we have reached here a major new step towards more federalism in Europe. So that's really very positive, but I will show you that it's not enough and that further steps will need to be taken. Okay, so that was a little bit my introduction. I'm happy to also take questions on the way, but we can also have, of course, detailed questions in the end. So let me start with the motivation for this banking union, this infamous banking union that is now discussed by many people. Now, I would start by saying that the problems in the banking system are really at the core of the euro area crisis. We have seen last year a very serious fragmentation of the financial system in the euro area. That fragmentation was so large that basically the interbank market was broke down along national borders. So in other words, banks were not treated as Eurozone banks anymore. They were treated as national banks and were treating each other as national banks and would not lend to other banks in countries in the same currency area, but outside of their own country. In other words, we have a breakdown of the interbank market, a very serious fragmentation of financial intermediation in the Eurozone. And of course, if you think about a common currency area, a common currency area that has no functioning interbank market, no functioning financial market, essentially stops being a sensible currency area. I mean, basically it starts being a fragmented area where the benefits of a common currency, which is, of course, capital market integration, are foregone. So that was a very serious situation last year. And the way this situation was addressed and had to be addressed was that the ECB, the European Central Bank, stepped in as a financial intermediary. The European Central Bank started to provide liquidity to banks in need across the Eurozone, and of course received liquidity, excess liquidities from other banks, and thereby essentially replaced the functioning of the interbank market. So before we had an interbank market, banks in some countries would lend to banks in other countries. Now it was the ECB that became the financial intermediary. Now this has been so extreme that it's even within banking groups, major banking groups such as Santander or UniCredit, within the groups, the liquidity provisioning within the groups stopped functioning well. So take an example like UniCredit, so a major Italian bank that had major and still has major subsidiaries in Germany. Basically, the liquidity of that was situated in the subsidiaries in Germany was not allowed to be used for operations, liquidity operations in Italy. Meaning that even within the banking group, the liquidity mechanism didn't really work, and so UniCredit actually had to go via the ECB to get the liquidity in Italy that it needed. And the amounts of money that we are talking about were very significant. In the case of UniCredit, it was in the dozens of billions of euros. So even within banking groups, the single banking market broke down last year. Now, of course, in such a situation, you see not just the banking system being affected, you also see the corporate credit conditions being very much negatively affected. And of course, at the same time, we saw a very strong emergence of sovereign risk. So risk measures in the sovereign bond market were increasing dramatically. Now, what happened is basically that this became a major doom loop which affected entire economies. We saw some countries' borrowing conditions in the bond market, sovereign bond market, corporate bond market, and banking bond market completely collapse. And to illustrate this, let me show you my next slide, which provides here a risk measure of bonds of the sovereign government, so 5-year bonds of the Italian government, then a basket of 5-year bonds of non-financial corporations in Italy, and a basket of financial corporations in Italy. And the risk measure is a credit default swap here. And what you see is basically you see a very strong correlation between these three risks. So you see whenever sovereign risk was high, the entire economy was priced with a very high risk. And whenever sovereign risk came down, also the other risk is coming down. So a very high degree of correlation. And of course you see also a very high sovereign risk premium, a very high risk premium for the entire corporate sector in the middle of last year, amounting to here 400 basis points, so 4 percentage points. Very prohibitive conditions for business to actually do invest. Now, this very strong correlation was also present in Spain. It's the same picture, essentially. But of course, in my home country, you don't see it. In my home country, in Germany, you see that the German bonds, so the government bonds, had a very minor sovereign risk attached to it. And of course, we have the normal ordering that non-financial corporations pay a little bit of a risk premium over the government, and then the banks pay over the corporations. Okay, so we have here, if you look at these three pictures, you see that there's a really a dramatically diverging conditions, financial conditions for governments, banks, and corporations in the three countries. Now, these dramatic, dramatically bad conditions, of course, have a very negative effect also on the real economy. Now, many people say, well, we need more real economic adjustment in the south of Europe, and it's true we need a decline in unit labor cost, but of course, if unit labor costs go down and capital costs go up, then the competitiveness of firms in southern Europe still stays very bad. So you need basically a decline in unit labor costs and a decline in capital costs, or at least good capital cost conditions. So this was really affecting economies across the board. Now, the European system, of course, saw this, and in June, the European Council had a very powerful summit conclusion with one sentence, the first sentence of that statement. So the heads of state were signing this document, and the first sentence of the statement is to say, we affirm that it is imperative to break the vicious circle between banks and sovereigns. So a very powerful statement by the heads of states to essentially prevent that risk in the banking system would translate into risk in the sovereign system, or risk in the sovereigns would translate into risk in the banking system. So the big question is, what have we achieved to date? What are the next steps? What are the implications beyond Europe, of course? So the heads of state, just to repeat what the heads of state actually declared, so let me translate the language of the heads of state into an economist speak. So an economist would say, the heads of state said, we want to reduce the correlation between these three lines to zero. Now it's one, but we want to have this correlation to be zero. Okay, so that's a translation, economic translation. So what have we achieved? Well, first of all, the decoupling is still not achieved. That's clear. You see, if you look at the slides, you see the correlation is very high. Of course, what you see is also you see that the risk is coming down. And the reason that the risk is coming down, the main reason that I would identify is the announcement by the ECB's president, Draghi, in the summer of last year to actually remove the catastrophic risk scenarios. So he said essentially, we will do whatever it takes to prevent a collapse of the common currency in a famous speech in London. And markets actually reacted very quickly to that announcement. And then, you know, he had to, so the story goes that he actually made that announcement without being absolutely sure what he wanted to do. And then the governing council of the Eurosystem decided to embark on the so-called OMT program, which is a program that basically allows the ECB to buy unlimited amounts of government bonds if there is a financial assistance program. Now, the effect of this was huge. It was just an announcement, but as you see, when it was announced in the summer, risk came down very, very substantially without a program in Spain and without a program in Italy. So there was no purchase of government bonds, yet still it came down very significantly. So it's a huge achievement here. And, well, I don't want to bore you with economic theory, but basically there was a very influential paper by Paul de Grauwe at the time who said, basically, we need to prevent self-fulfilling crisis. And what we saw certainly in the summer of last year, it was the risk of a self-fulfilling crisis. And the ECB essentially said, we don't accept self-fulfilling crisis. Okay, so that's a major achievement. Now, the big question, of course, that remains is, what if? So what if the debt levels that we have here and the price adjustment trajectory that is out there is not sustainable? What would the ECB do? And that's really the big question. So one view, of course, is, and that view is very much currently is subscribed to by the markets, is that basically Spain and Italy are sustainable countries, but they are, you know, they were pushed in a bad equilibrium from the markets, and now that this is prevented, and now they will basically manage to survive. Now, there's, of course, a more skeptical view that says, well, especially Spain has an external debt to GDP ratio of around 100%, so very high debt level. It's not just the government debt, it's the private sector also that has a lot of debt, 100%. And it has to adjust its price level downwards by another, let me be pessimistic, 5% or 10%, meaning that the real value of debt increases because your price level goes down. And this will be so dramatic that basically the Spanish government will not be able to sustain the kind of deleveraging without any inflation. I mean, it's basically, I mean, that's the kind of the paradox of the South. So when you have too much debt, what you need usually is you need more inflation. But of course, when you have too much debt, in the case of the euro area, what you need is you need lower prices to regain competitiveness. So basically, the south of Europe needs to have less inflation and more inflation at the same time, right? They need more inflation to get rid of the debt level, but they need less inflation to become competitive. And as you know, it's not possible to solve this paradox. So the adjustment now comes basically from the deficits and from savings. And that is being felt very dramatically in the south of Europe at the moment, with unemployment rates increasing dramatically. And let me just show you this figure, because I found it actually very impressive. It shows you the unemployment in the euro area as a whole. And you see this dramatic increase in the number of unemployed from 11 million to 19 million currently, and you don't see an inflection point, right? It's going up like this, and you know it doesn't stabilize, so it's increasing. And well, that's ultimately, I'm as an economist, I have to be silent basically now, because I don't know how much the social and political system in the south of Europe can actually absorb. But certainly, when you have a situation where youth unemployment is 50%. Then it becomes very difficult to sustain this for a very long time. So it's a very dramatic social situation in the south of Europe. And basically, at the moment, the solutions that we have at the moment on the table do not really address this dramatic growth issue in the south of Europe. So in other words, I think the issue of further fiscal integration as a way to help the south of Europe will remain on the table. It will come back. I don't think the issue will go away, and it's basically a result of the way the eurozone is structured. I mean, the eurozone has currently no fiscal integration, or very little fiscal integration, and so no fiscal mechanisms to offset the kind of adjustment processes that we are currently observing. And let me talk a little bit more about these processes. Now, let me nevertheless spend, and you tell me in terms of time when I'm running, when I'm speaking too long. It's okay still?
Well, it's okay still.
Still okay? Okay. So let me discuss perhaps a bit more quicker now the central achievements on the banking union that we've done, and then the central steps that, in my view, still have to be taken on the fiscal front, okay? Now, on the banking union, we have now an agreement to form a common supervisor. I think this is a very strong agreement. The ECB will have very far-reaching competences and responsibility for the overall system. There was a lot of debate whether the ECB would actually just supervise 150 banks and not all 7,000 banks or 6,000 banks in the eurozone. I think if you read the final text, it's quite clear that the ECB will be able to grab all the relevant banks and supervise all the relevant banks if it wishes to. It's a very strong statement. I mean, they have responsibility for the overall system. They can take on small banks if there's a case that they should take them on. Okay, so that's a major step, and I think it will be a very important step to help stabilize the financial situation, not least because it will help stop the absurd situation that we have currently, where within banking groups, as I told you about Unit Credit and Santander, the liquidity operations are not working anymore because of national regulatory action. This will be removed by the common supervisor. There's also a political agreement to move to the next step, namely a single resolution mechanism. The European Council in December very clearly says we want to work on a common resolution mechanism, but it stops there. So it's just an announcement that something has to be done there. But still, I take it as a very positive sign, because it is the first time that the European heads of state and government have said very clearly something needs to be done there. We need a single resolution mechanism. Up to the December summit, it was always said, well, resolution can be done nationally. Now it's said we need a single resolution mechanism. But this is not an easy task. It's both technically and politically very difficult. Technically, it's very difficult because you have to think about legal differences in legal systems, it's insolvency law, labor law, and so on. Politically, it's very difficult, of course, because basically you would give the power to some form of common mechanism to close down and change the ownership structure of banks across the Eurozone. I mean, that's a major, major step. And I don't expect a lot of progress on this front in this year. I expect quite some proposals coming out, but I don't think there will be any political agreement to move forward on this step. It's a major step. Then the third part of the banking union is the so-called fiscal backstop. We actually presented a paper in October at the ECOFIN in Nicosia in Cyprus to the ministers, in which we discussed this issue. And what I'm showing you is now basically from this minister note. And of course, what we argue there is that the first step of the resolution of any banking problems should be to minimize the cost to the taxpayer, so to get creditor bail-in. And that is, but we also argue that this is not enough. The fiscal backstop is actually a central part of bank resolution, and it cannot, without this central part of bank resolution, we cannot achieve the ultimate game of the June summit, namely to decouple banks from sovereigns. So there is an issue of fiscal risk sharing, and let me just show you one chart to illustrate why this fiscal risk sharing is important. What I show here, I show here the costs of banking crisis in the last 40 years in an IMF sample, IMF data set. And what you see is that more than 50% of, around 50% of banking crisis cost more than 5% of GDP. The most biggest case here is, of course, 40% of GDP, 40-45% of GDP. Ireland falls into this category. The cost of the Irish banking crisis was 40%, 40% of Irish GDP. If we leave these big risks at the mercy of national taxpayers alone, then we will never be able to break this high correlation between banking risk and sovereign risk that we observed initially. So if you want to remove that correlation, as the June summit says, then you need to agree on some form of burden sharing. So, of course, I would argue this is a central part of bank resolution. You need to find some form of bank fiscal backstop. Ideally, you want to create something similar to the US FDIC. But what the big question is, what can be done in the current treaty framework? There's no agreement on that, and significant work has to be done on this. So one big issue is the long-term design. The other big issue there is, how do we deal with the legacy? That's an infamous issue by now. Of course, introducing some form of common insurance is almost impossible in a situation where half of the population is sick, right? So because the other half will know, basically we have to pay the other half. So it's like in a health insurance system, introducing a health insurance when many people are sick or to a sick person is not happening. You always have a health check before you get access to the health insurance. And that's the same in Europe at the moment. We know that some banks in some countries are particularly affected. And of course, the other countries do not like the notion of bailing out those banks. It's a very, very natural political response. Now, the option that is, and I don't think there will be an easy solution for this. I think ultimately there will have to be a political solution, but it's really not, an economist cannot contribute much there. I mean, it's basically, I mean, the political system needs to find a way of how to deal with the legacy. Now, one option of how this could be done is to use the ESM, the European Stability Mechanism, but this faces numerous obstacles, not least the fact that the implementation of the ESM treaty into German law prevents and does not allow for direct bank recapitalization. So we would have to have a vote in the German Bundestag to change the German implementation of the ESM treaty, which is certainly not going to be happening before the German elections. So that's until September, nothing will happen there. Now, let me talk a little bit more about fiscal integration, and perhaps then I skip the part on impact on Asia, because that's obvious, I guess. So on the fiscal integration, so what if the current debt level is not sustainable because of the combination of high external debt and remaining price adjustment needs? Well, first of all, OMT is not a solution to that situation. The ECB can prevent bad equilibria, but it cannot solve unsustainable fiscal policy. If it was to solve unsustainable fiscal policy, it would create inflation, and that's, of course, not in its mandate, and it's not desirable for a number of reasons. So then you have to find other solutions. The other big other solution would be default, but that's also not really a solution because the contagion effects are large. Now, there are currently two proposals basically on the table to solve this dilemma. One is to create some form of a euro area budget to provide support to countries in need. The other one is a partial debt mutualization mechanism. The big questions there are, and here I want to criticize my own profession, the economists. The economists typically talk about the technical details of how this could be done, but in my view, that's really secondary. The main question there is, what is the institutional basis that is required for such further fiscal integration? Certainly, the current fiscal surveillance that we have in the Eurozone is not sufficient. There's a big institutional question about debt issuance agency. How could it look like? Should the ESM become the euro area treasury? And so on. I mean, these are major questions, and they are very much about political and fiscal integration and institutional integration, and not so much about the economic details of it. Perhaps one more word on the euro area budget. So before the European summit in December, there was really a very vigorous debate on the issue, and there was quite some hope that Herman Van Rompuy, the president of the European Council, would be able to at least advance the debate on a euro area budget further. Now, this has been stopped in December, or at least delayed, but as I said, I'm sure this will resurface because it's going to be a very important issue due to the very restrictive fiscal and monetary policies in the south of Europe. Now, if you look at the old insights from fiscal federalism, which I did, actually I digged out a beautiful paper from 1968 by William Oates. Now, in this paper, he shows very clearly that fiscal stabilization policies, so counteracting negative shocks in a country, in a region, cannot be done at a regional level. It cannot be done at a regional level because countries or regions will be priced out of the market. It's a very old insight, shown in a nice model in 1968, which directly contradicts the consensus of the Maastricht Treaty. The Maastricht Treaty said, well, fiscal stabilization can be done at a national level. There's no need for any mechanisms at the Eurozone level. Now, I think we see very clearly that this is not enough. And let me show you two graphs that demonstrate this. One is a very simple graph showing sovereign bond yields and relating them to the external debt position of countries. And you see very clearly that a number of countries effectively are prevented from doing fiscal stabilization policy because of high bond yields. Portugal, Ireland, Spain, Cyprus, they are all starting to be priced out of the market. Also Italy, that was in the summer of last year. So stabilization policy really had its limits here. Now, of course, there are other stabilization channels for regional shocks. I also looked at the literature for the US, which was actually a very interesting literature in the middle of the 90s, studying the US in view of European Monetary Union. And the famous paper by Astrobaldi et al. Looks at what other factors smooth regional shocks. And they find capital markets are very important and credit markets are very important. Now, the problem with capital markets is that in Europe, capital markets are still very much home-biased. So here I compare the theoretical share of home holdings with the actual ones. So in other words, suppose you were an investor located in Germany. Where would you invest your savings in? Well, if you consider the Eurozone as being one economy, you would basically invest, and that's the blue one, the theoretical one, you would invest 25% in Germany. You would invest a little bit more in France, actually, because the stock market is bigger there. You would invest very little in Portugal and in Italy and so on. Now, de facto, you're investing more than 80% of your assets in Germany. And that's the same in all the countries. In other words, if there's a regional shock, it's not just that you lose your job, but you also your assets are worth nothing anymore because your assets are invested in the same country in which you live, and this country is dragged downwards. So this capital channel of smoothing shocks also not really work. So I think these are two reasons, two very powerful reasons why I think ultimately we need some form of fiscal stabilization at a Eurozone level. Now then you can have a big debate, how do you want to organize this? Certainly it will be impossible to do the same thing as the United States have been doing, namely shifting spending, 50% or 60% of government spending to the federal level. I mean, that's unthinkable in Europe, of course. But I think what we could do in Europe is we could have some form of high-powered fiscal transfer system that is neutral, distributionally neutral ex ante. So it would be a system that would only react to negative shocks and positive shocks, but not to long-term level differences. You could create such a system, and I think it would be immensely helpful. We have done some simulations and so on. And I think, you know, basically with 2% of euro area GDP, you can really smooth out a lot of the major negative shocks that we are observing. Okay, perhaps that was already a bit long, but perhaps I thought it was good to kind of give the overview, and these were the two major institutional reforms that are discussed, banking union and fiscal union. Banking union very much related to fiscal union also, so you cannot separate the banking union discussion completely from the fiscal union discussion. And then I'm just happy to take more questions and discuss further. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Actually, you raised many questions rather than providing answers. And I'm sure there are many questions and comments on your presentation. The original sin of the Eurozone, I suppose, is monetary union without fiscal union. So as you illustrated this. We all know that fiscal union is needed, and banking union is needed. And I think Europeans, although you're muddling through, but this did make a substantial progress, but still, we're not quite at the final point. And so we all know the, you know, which direction the Eurozone should be the heading toward. But the thing is how soon that will happen. And so what's going to happen this year, particularly, I'm sure, the Eurozone is in recession now, and whether or not this year the region will perform better than the last year, that is the question. So the Bruegel has any forecast on this year's the Eurozone economies?
Well, I mean, we are not doing full-fledged forecasts, but certainly I think the unemployment figures quite clearly show that the trend is still bad. And you know, if I look at the policy measures that are being undertaken, I mean, I think very important to stabilize the financial system. That was a crucial step, and you know, the banking is very crucial for the stability of the whole Eurozone. But what is not on the table really is something to address the weak growth in the south of Europe, and I think this needs to be addressed, not least for political and social stability, but also for growth in the entire area. And I don't see any concrete measures on the table that would really help. I mean, of course, there are some smaller contributions here and there. The EU budget is supposed to be a little bit reshaped, but you know, then we are talking about 5 billion here, 10 billion here. It's not, you know, the kind of macroeconomic measures that would help stimulate growth.
Yeah, and at the EU level, the situation is like that. But I think the German economy is again the key. Yesterday, the day before yesterday, the Spanish Prime Minister said that you cannot ask the Spanish government to have an expansionary policy, but you can ask Germans to have more expansionary policy because German can afford it. And so you cannot force austerity, all the expansionary policy to every country, particularly those the fiscal fiscally troubled countries. But German the fiscal position is much better, so Germans can afford to have more expansionary policy, and that would help the rest of the European Eurozone countries. And do you think because of the coming election, that would be difficult for Germans to go ahead with this kind of policies or not?
Well, here that's the paradox, right? In every country of the world, it would help to have a fiscal expansion before your election to get re-elected. In Germany, it's probably the opposite.
The opposite, yes.
But more seriously speaking, I think Rajoy is right on the Spanish side. I mean, I think it was the whole debate on the speed of adjustment, fiscal adjustment in the south of Europe. I personally think that if you do the adjustment early on, you signal that you are credible, and you will get quite a bit of benefits in terms of reduced market pressure and so on. I think this whole discussion about the fiscal multiplier that was triggered by Olivier Blanchard, I personally fall more on the German side there, thinking the multiplier is actually, especially in the countries that are really under heavy market pressure, the multiplier is not at all that large. I mean, on the contrary, if you credibly consolidate early on, then you will regain and become credible and thereby regain better funding conditions for your corporations, which will help you actually grow. So I think that's really important. Now the other question is on the macro stance for the area as a whole. Now this solution that is often advocated of a fiscal expansion in Germany, I'm a little bit more skeptical, I have to say. I mean, I first of all, think we shouldn't overestimate the impact of fiscal expansion in Germany on the south of Europe. I mean, this, a lot of fiscal expansion falls on domestic production and so on, and the cross-border multipliers are not so big; they are actually quite small. And second of all, I think the real issue is in my view at least that temporarily, in extremely bad times, you need outside assistance. I mean, basically, what happens in any fiscal fiscal union is that the country, the region affected, would get some outside resources in one form or another, and that's what helped this region directly. I mean, it's not that. Let's say if there's a drop in a dramatic decline in demand in Pennsylvania. You don't do a fiscal expansion in California to help Pennsylvania, right? I mean, what you do is you find a little bit of resources that will help smooth the effects of the shock in Pennsylvania, right? And that think that is, and there I would disagree with Rajoy. So I think the issue is not primarily German fiscal expansion. Now the other issue, which is perhaps the more relevant, is certainly the macro adjustment, which currently is done mostly in the deficit countries in terms of the wages, whereas wages in Germany, and I looked at the data, wages in Germany are now a little bit above the average. I mean, they are not a little bit, but let's say they are now at 2.8%, if I remember correctly. The average is around 2 or so. There I think there's more scope, and that would be a more lasting readjustment also. I mean, if we have a relative adjustment of wages. But that's also, of course, politically controversial, even though I think the German government would actually win the elections even more easily if wages were to increase a little bit more. And Wolfgang Schäuble, the German finance minister, has said that this would make sense also. I mean, so I have some hope there.
Okay, now, let me invite any questions and comments from the floor. Yes. Yes, Mr. Speckman.
Thank you. Dr. Wolf, thank you very much for your presentation. Currently, there is a debate going on within the UK about how it's going to change its role. If it were to change its role for a greater role or maybe lesser than what it's playing now, what would be some of the implications and the impact on the European Union or Great Britain?
Boring in the UK?
UK, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, why don't you collect a few more questions? Yes, Dr. Kim.
You mentioned about the currency union or the optimum currency area. Do you believe in Mundell's optimum currency area? And one of the primary conditions was free mobility, labor mobility. Is it not possible that much of the unemployed people in the problem zone area, like to or can go and move to France, Germany, or other non-problem countries? And it is, second question is, there's a rumor that perhaps And people like Krugman or other scholars had prematurely forecast or predict or speculated that these five countries would, should be separated, from the Eurozone. Perhaps it's not possible now, but is it likely or is it feasible that they could have a kind of quasi-regional currency, parallel currency, so that they can take care of the transitional problem? Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
That's already three. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, on the quasi-currency or the leave of absence, I mean, I don't believe in this at all. I mean, I think this is, let me put it politely, this is very difficult to imagine how that would work. I mean, a fiat currency, a currency always relies on the fact that you have trust in this currency as being the legal tender that is really the applicable to all financial transactions. Now, if you start introducing a second currency in parallel, you get all kinds of distortions in the economy and you don't really solve much of the problem. So, of course, the other option then, the more radical option, is to say you leave the currency union. Now, we had debates, of course, about this, as you all know, about Grexit and so on. I think if you do the cost-benefit analysis, it's very difficult to do. But what you certainly see very clearly is that there's a very big risk. There's a very big risk, and you cannot really quantify that risk. And so, if you then are in a policy-making situation, I think you basically say, well, this risk is too high to be taken, and that's what is currently the consensus in Europe, certainly. The risk to leave the currency area is very high. It's high for the country that would leave. It's high for the rest. And so that's why none of the countries currently have left. The risk is just too high. So I don't think this... these discussions about a currency, quasi-currency, and so on would help you. Your debt will stay in the old currency, right? So even if your prices then adjust, but then your debt level is still in the old currency. So I think it's wrong. Now, on Robert Mundell, I mean, that's of course a very, very crucial question. Now, let me put it this way. I think... Again, in Europe, the glass is half full or half empty, the way, depending on the way you see it. I think you see quite a bit of migration starting now. I think it's underestimated. We want to do more research on that, but it's starting. It's really there. People start moving. It's not necessarily now the Spanish, so to speak, that are from Spain that are moving, but there were before in the boom period many people went to Spain, right? And these people are now leaving the country again. So there's quite a bit of migration already happening, and I think it will pick up. Now, is it easy? It's certainly much more difficult than in the U.S. because you have different languages, different cultures, and so on. I mean, I can only say it's, of course, also a skill mismatch problem. What do you do with a Spanish 20-year-old that, or 22-year-old that at the age of 16 dropped out of high school to work on a construction site because these jobs were just, extremely well paid? And, he's 22, doesn't have an education, and so on. I mean, it's not that, Germany would need exactly that kind of job profile, right? I mean, of course, it would be good to have these people work in the German small and medium-sized enterprises in the high-tech sector. But, it doesn't really match the skill profile, and that's a major problem. And it's not, but I think that's a general problem, which would happen in other currency areas as well. I mean, the steel workers in Pennsylvania didn't find job in Silicon Valley, right? But it's an important issue. Then the UK, I mean, I think that's probably one of the more fundamental issues that we will see in the next couple of years, what stance will the UK take on all these issues? I mean, they, so far on the banking union discussion, they have been relatively prudent, I would say. They have said, well, we acknowledge that you have to fix the system, so go ahead. But of course, at the same time, they cannot accept, and they have bargained very hard on this issue, that the Eurozone doesn't become too strong so that it would ultimately be able to control the entire regulation of the financial system in the EU as a whole. I mean, that's the big debate there, right? The big debate is to what extent the UK can get exemption clauses, being able to block new regulations on the banking union front, new banking regulations. So that's the big issue. Then more broadly, if you talk about more fiscal integration and so on, I think it's a huge issue to what extent the UK can stay apart from, you know, a stronger political and fiscal integration in the Eurozone, and what it will mean for the relations between the Eurozone and the UK. I mean, we have a lot of debate with our UK friends. You also know that the EU skepticism in the UK is very high now. Among the population, for sure, among the popular press, and so on. So it's not an easy game for the UK to play at the moment. It's not easy.
What are their fears, the UK people?
Well, I mean, I think it's not always rational. I mean, the let's say in the population at large and in the mass media, Europe is portrayed as, you know, the big bureaucratic monstrum that is undermining the freedom, classical freedom, and the liberty of the country. So that's in the mass media. Now, the political system and the bureaucracy, of course, the bureaucracy very much understands the benefits of the single market and is actually trying currently to push that agenda a bit more. So currently, the UK government is starting an initiative to assess the benefits of the single market in a very, you know, let's say technical way, to then make a case later on that, you know, there's actually a very big benefit for the UK to be in the European Union.
To the leading countries like Germany and France,
you welcome the UK into the Union, if you could meet on these negotiating points?
Well, I guess you have to ask Mr. Ambassador, but...
yes.
But, I mean, I think certainly, yeah, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you want to say something?
Well, thank you very much. If I may, I mean, for Germany, it is very important that the UK stays within the European Union. We have a very similar agenda on many political issues, whether it's trade, whether it's environment. And so it would be a strong weakening of the European Union if the UK decided to go its own way. But on the other hand, it is extremely difficult to imagine that they would go their own way from their own interest. If they would be considering a status like Switzerland, since they are mainly focusing on the economic side and on the trade side, this is where there's a kind of consensus probably within the UK population. In that regard, we want to be part of Europe or of the EU. But in terms of the full integration,
EU keeps moving in to more integration, and all what we have seen here means more integration.
It will mean less national sovereignty. And this is precisely where the UK and UK population is very concerned about, of ceding sovereignty to the European level, ceding sovereignty to Brussels. Now, if you then go for a format which is the one like Norway or Switzerland, what would be the effect? The effect would be that if you're not inside, you're not capable of determining the rules. Still, you are part of the overall market, you're part of this environment, and therefore, nevertheless, you have to implement all the rules. So the situation would be much worse being outside. But in general terms, it's very clear from a German perspective. We want the UK in, and we need the UK in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador, for this. Okay, now, yes, Dr. Kim is heading Hyundai Research Institute. Yeah,
thank you, Dr. Wolf. I wonder, how do you see the economic recovery of southern European countries like Greece, Italy, and Spain, and Portugal? Even though you say the Spain is getting better, but how do you see the Greece and Italy? Do you think they can go over the restructuring process so far?
Shall we collect again?
You should, please, yeah. Yeah. Why don't you yes, respond
okay.
this?
No, I mean, let me start with a positive message on Spain. So if you look at the last 4 years in Spain, you see a very strong performance of the export industry. The export industry, Spanish export industry, is currently driving growth in Spain, what remains of growth. Now, at the same time, demand collapsed, of course, this led to a massive surge in unemployment. The labor market remains very segmented between the insiders and the outsiders. And basically, all those people that worked in the non-tradable sector, is in particular in construction, they don't have a new job, and they don't find a new job. And it will take quite a bit of time until they will actually be able to get jobs in the tradable industry, which is where they should get jobs. Now, this will depend mostly on the ability of the export industry to actually grow more than they do currently. Now, they have grown, the numbers are really astonishing. In the last 4 years, the Spanish export industry was number two in terms of growth of exports in the Eurozone, better than German exports. They grew in growth terms faster than Germany. Only Estonia was quicker, actually. So only a very tiny, small country. Estonia was quicker, but Spain was number two. Now, of course, last year they had a huge problem because they couldn't invest anymore because they didn't have access to finance. I mean, the financial system broke down, and you had to invest. So that was a major obstacle, and that's getting better now. So there's some ground for optimism there. But as I said, I mean, overall, the financial conditions are still restrictive, still 200 basis points over German corporations, meaning you really have a major competitive disadvantage, and certainly the fiscal stance is also restrictive, also not helping. So I think the growth issue in Southern Europe is going to be disastrous this year still, while with some hope next year we will see a reversal in Spain. Now the other countries, Greece is a sad story that is a very long and very sad story, but certainly the economic performance in Greece is not going to be brilliant this year. I think the program as it is designed currently, as the financial assistance program, relies on pretty optimistic assumptions still. So we may actually have to have another official sector involvement in Greece. First official sector involvement, but a haircut basically on the debt. Mm-hmm. Now Italy is Italy. In Italy, a lot depends on the kind of structural reforms that have been done. I have to say the current government has been very successful in regaining confidence in the markets. It has reestablished credibility in terms of fiscal policy, so very important steps. But a lot remains to be done, especially in the labor market reforms. Mm. So I would say Italy is also not brilliant this year. It's not brilliant, not going to be brilliant this year in terms of growth rates. I mean, even German growth in the fourth quarter of last year was very, very weak, very weak. So the overall stance is very restrictive still. Mm.
Okay. Any more questions or comments? Well, this is...
I think that the political cooperation among very strong financial institutions in Europe is also very important for solving the financial instability in Europe. I have seen last year, at the end of the last year, that President Draghi of the European Central Bank has pushed the expansionary policy in spite of the resistance of the Bundesbank of Germany. In this respect, if the political cooperation among these important institutions are harmed, how can the European financial crisis be solved in the reality? And probably Draghi has seen the main reason of the financial crisis as from the in the illiquidity problem, but most specialists in the Bundesbank see the main reason probably in the insolvency problem of the banks. What is the perspective of this political cooperation or the in regarding the instability of the financial problems? I want to hear your opinion. Thank you.
Well, no, that's, I mean, so first of all, the liquidity versus solvency, I think that's a very good point. I mean, I think the Bundesbank has actually quite a consistent view on the issues. I mean, the Bundesbank, what the Bundesbank says is basically, yes, there are solvency problems in the financial system, the banks, but also in the government system. And so if we want to find a lasting solution to the problems that are out there, then we need to agree politically on the fiscal measures that need to be taken, because fiscal policy is the instrument to be used, and of course default, to be used in case of insolvency, whereas monetary policy is to be used, liquidity policy is to be used for liquidity problems, right? So the Bundesbank, actually, if you read Jens Weidmann, I mean, the current Bundesbank president, he is always saying very clearly, we need to move ahead with more political integration. And this will form the basis for more fiscal integration and so on. And I think he's right on that. So he's right on that in the long run, right? Now, on the other hand, I also have to say, you know, announcing things that will not be achieved easily is also not enough. I mean, the situation was so dramatic last year that something had to be taken, had to be done. And as you know, the decision that the governing council of the ECB has taken. Certainly was not done against the will of the major member states. So the governments, of course, have been giving their tacit agreement, at least, to the measures. So in a sense, there has been a political agreement to move ahead with the measure based on what is currently available. Now, I think there's also quite a bit of reason to believe that a lot of what we have observed since the summer is really an improvement in the liquidity conditions. I don't think the pricing in the summer of last year was adequate. I think it was really reflecting self-fulfilling crisis, market disequilibria. So in that sense, the ECB took the right decision, saying this is something which we need to address. Monetary policy is not operating properly anymore, so we need to use monetary policy instruments to address this. Now, in terms of the cooperation within the Eurosystem, the political cooperation, I think it's normal to have debates in the Eurosystem. I think that's the way it should be. I mean, different players have different views and different interests, and they should really debate. Now, I'm not always convinced that it should be done so publicly, but in some cases it's good, and it's a balancing act for the Bundesbank how public they should be on their criticism. If they are too public, it's on too many issues, it's undermining the credibility of the entire system, but a little bit public is okay. So, you know, it's a balancing act, it's not easy to do. But I just want to stress one thing. I mean, the Eurosystem is functioning extremely efficiently. Of course, the Bundesbank president can announce and say, I don't think this is the right policy, But he would never announce that he would not implement the policies that have been decided. I mean, there's a clear framework, legal structure. If a decision is taken, a joint decision is taken, of course, every central bank in the Eurosystem implements that decision. So, I mean, the system operates extremely well. I mean, even though, of course, there are divisions and different views. So I'm not so pessimistic on the Eurosystem.
Okay, good. Okay.
Chair Mr. Gong, can I make one quick request to the speaker? Can you elaborate on the bullet point you're showing on the slide on Eurobond solution implications for global reserve currency for the benefit of our audience understanding?
Oh, yes. Yes, I didn't really discuss this. So, I think if we go ahead with more fiscal integration and we create some form of common bonds, I mean, then, of course, the big question is, how attractive will that be? And I think it will be very attractive. I mean, if it's based on a sound institutional footing, it will be a very attractive global asset, which has a very low risk. And of course, then I think there are major players around the globe that may want to diversify away from the U.S. T-bills. And so I would say this would probably lead to pretty significant capital inflows into Europe. But, you know, I mean, first we have to take the step in Europe. And if that step is taken, I think it will actually change the landscape in terms of global reserve currency holdings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I think we have to end this very interesting session now. I think the major characteristics of the Eurozone situation is in terms of policy making and policy implementation is muddling through. But that muddling through has been toward the right direction. For that reason, I am from outside the observer. I've been on an optimistic side, because we can all remember only a few years back, banking union in Europe is almost kind of taboo word. But as you presented there, this substantial progress has been made in the banking union area, although there are a lot more to be done. And again, fiscal side, again, exactly for that reason, again, as Ambassador well elaborated, the British are very concerned about joining the European Union. So the process has been progressing very slowly, but toward the right direction, and it has been making progress. But taking more shorter time perspective this year, I don't think there will be major breakthrough again. And what that means is, bottom line is that the Eurozone economy will still be in a rather troubled situation. But I think this year may be better than last year, though.
Yes.
Particularly toward the second half of this year. So with that, and also we had Alan Sinai last week, and also he ended up with more optimistic note on the U.S. economy because politicians don't want to be blamed for ruining the economy. So in the end, I think there somehow U.S. will avoid the fiscal cliff, maybe in the last minutes. And the Chinese economy is getting better. There will be no hard landing as such. So with all this, I think we can at least have a finger closed and wish for better second half. Okay, with this we have to end. Please join me. Thank you.